Welcome, Priyanka, to News Central 24/7. I feel that it's such an honor to be talking to you today.
Thank you, Natasha. Thank you very much to you and to News Central for this conversation.
So, Priyanka, Dubey has just written a book called No Nation for Women. And here's what it says on the blurb. No Nation for Women takes a hard, close look at what makes India unsafe for its women. From custodial rapes and honor killings to rapes of minors and trafficking. The author, Priyanka, uncovers many unpalatable truths behind what we are familiar with as newspaper headlines only. But what makes this book really so important in a sense, Priyanka, is that it's not just talking about violence against women. As you tell the stories, these horrific, brutal stories of violence against individual women, what you are uncovering is a web of violence of the upper caste against Dalits in this country, of the state against its own minorities and tribals, of communities with each other, of violence within families, and it is really just the bodies of women that the violence is being inflicted upon, when actually the conflict is, is more structural. And as you take us from chapter to chapter, from state to state in this book, that's the web that you've really revealed, and that's what makes this book so important for us. You've spent years as a reporter, and many of these stories are stories that you were also reporting. At what point did you feel that you needed to go beyond the news story? What kind of frustration or wall must it have been that made you feel that you had to write a book on this?
Thank you, Natasha, for such a beautiful introduction of the book. I agree when you say that when the violence is more structural, women bodies are normally, are being used just as a tool in that violence. So before coming to that question, I want to say that I feel that from my reporting experience, I feel that women bodies have been used as battlegrounds, to fight different wars like caste wars, class wars, and community wars. So and violating a women's body sexually has been a way of showing power, of exerting, of pulling down a certain community, or of just implying torture on the other community to a large extent. Coming back to the question, this book, I think I've been a magazine reporter for a long period in my reporting career, and when you work in a magazine, we always look for references. We try to dig out more information about the subject that we are reporting on. So when I reported on gender, and during my reporting career, I started looking for references for books to enhance my knowledge and my understanding of this complex subject of gender violence in India. So when I started looking, I could not get my hands on many reportage based books. There were many books, but there were edited essays or anthologies, and there were a couple of very good books by Urvashi ji but they were about the gender violence that happened around partition. So I felt that there was a gap, there was a need of this kind of book, because there is a lot of noise about gender violence, and we have started talking about it slowly now, but when it comes to solid things, like solid material which we can pick up, and if you want to read, or if you want to have a first good knowledge of what is gender violence like in India, there was nothing, and I felt that this pop, just like this country, gender violence is very diverse. It's crime against women, we cannot put our finger on one thing and make a sweeping generalization. So it changes from state to state, from one community to other community. A lot of factors contribute to every case of gender violence that happens in India. So it's very nuanced. It's multidimensional, and I do not agree with sweeping generalizations. So the idea of the book originated from that point. I also wanted to give longer shelf life to the work that I was doing, so that there's something for people to read and to understand. And also, there's a funny background anecdote about it, that I wanted to, there was a lot of pressure on me to get married, and I wanted to push that away. So, you know, I also thought of
this. So a book deal was a good way.
Book deal was a good way to push my parents to say that I'm busy in something, a big project, and I just don't bother me now. I'm occupied for a couple of years. So people write book for different things, you know, because they want to write books. But it's ironic and funny in the same way that in this country, you know, women have to still, you know, women who have gathered.
It's like a PhD and a postdoctoral project.
Or some degree or something. Even women who have a lot of control, who have gathered that control in their lives, you know, through constant negotiation and constant struggle, they also have to come up with such things to push their marriage away.
And yet, once you got the book deal,
yeah,
and you began to write it,
yeah,
there must have been many moments when you were like, what have I gotten myself into?
Yes.
Or it did take you longer than you anticipated. In fact, you were married before the book came out.
yes, that's right.
So at the same time that you were trying to avoid the arranged marriage, yeah, you did fall in love, yeah, and yeah, and got married as well. what made it so hard to write this book once you embarked on the journey?
So there were a number of obstacles and number of challenges, mental, emotional challenges, and then the physical, apparent, worldly challenges. So let's first talk about the material worldly challenges, which includes the lack of resources.
Yeah.
So I freelanced in between because it's difficult to work on a project like this while working full time. So I was freelancing for a couple of years, I think around from early 2014 to end 2015. I was freelancing. So in those 2 years, I generated a lot of material, I reported, which is now part of this book. But it was difficult to gather, generate money, and then to finish this book. I applied for grants. It's, you know, I was living in out of a very cheap rented accommodation in Delhi. I cut down on my budget. I was not going out on holidays, and I invested all the money that I got from awards into this book. I diverted everything that I had in the book, and in the last two chapters, you know, one was based in one of the chapters I had to go to Kashmir, and one was in Northeast. So these two regions are difficult, so you have to take flights and vehicles which are sturdy and big, so there was a lot of investment. So in the end, I got a small grant to support these two chapters, very meager but enough to support these two chapters. So there was a lot of struggle to generate resources, to do and to sustain myself alone in Delhi. So that was one which was very on your face and tough. And then the second thing was, obviously, I used to think, what have I gotten myself into? Because after every report, you know, when you come back after and you are living in a small accommodation, a small rented room, you feel very alone. Freelancing is you are a freelancer, so you know it makes you feel lonely.
Yeah.
At times you cringe for that office space, you know. Obviously, when you are working full time, you again want to go back to freelancing. It's that thing. But I felt very lonely, and I felt that I'm walking towards darkness. Like it was like coming, going, and coming back, entering and then coming back, going into darkness and then coming back. And the book was always on my head 24/7. Like I could not enjoy myself, I could not even on festivals, or if you think of taking a break or vacation, you would feel responsible that you want to finish this. And with every passing year, you know, the burden becomes so big and so much, it kind of...
What was the emotional difficulty of writing the stories of people who were in so much pain?
Yeah.
I mean, that must have been a, you know, you can sit at your desk, but to connect with the survivor, the victim, and his or her pain, which is what you need to do as a writer every time you decide that you're going to write another few pages of this book. Tell us about that.
I think working on a book of this kind is a very self-harming process, you know, you voluntarily sign up for it. I did sign up for it because I believed, and I still believe, that the stories of these women are more important than my own, that the wounds that I am having, you know, in the process of working on this book. I believe that these stories are important, they need to be told, they should come out, people should know about it, so that people can know what is happening on the ground, what is wrong, and in my head I imagine that this will lead people to acknowledge the level of violence that is happening to women in India, which will in turn lead to course correction. So I thought that documentation is very important, non-fiction, so that we have something as proof that this is happening, you know, a thing which we can, you know, like slap or give to people. This is happening, and you need to acknowledge this.
And these are the details
of it. And this has happened. So from here, when we acknowledge, then the process of course correction starts. But first, we have to accept that this is happening. If you're living in urban utopias, this is not complete India. So that was one.
Or if you're living in that state of apathy where you say, yes, we know it's happening, but what can we do about it?
What can we do?
And it's just so pervasive that we've normalized it.
And many people say, nahi, aajkal to bada women empowerment ho gaya, ab kahan ye sab hota hai and all that. So that is really...
Which are just lies.
Lies,
yeah.
You know, such ironic lies, kyun aap uspe haso, ro, sar phodo, kya karo, aapke samajh nahi aayega. So I thought that this book should be a testament of what is happening to women in India, and it took me around 6 years to finish this book, and this has been and the situation has not improved. It has gotten only worse in past 6 years. So I think that makes it relevant. I think the idea was good, the intention was good, was appropriate, but it was very self-harming, you know. My process was, when I would interview, I would be quiet and silent, and like I really, I'm very patient in stories like this. You have to be very patient, and I genuinely wanted to know their story, so I have to be there, invest time, and when they open up, and the person, the survivor, her family opens up, you just listen to them, and with great patience, great, you know, just sense of the human spirit in which kindness, yeah, and human spirit in which we all are, yeah, bounded, you know, by each other as human beings. So I was just hanging on that thread. And आपको सवाल पूछने पड़ते हैं बहुत आहिस्ता से धीरे से बाद में कुछ आप सवाल पूछते हैं उनको वापस आपको उनकी उनसे सवाल पूछने पड़ते हैं कि घटना के बारे में तो है ही सवाल पूछने मगर बाकी ज़िंदगी के बारे में ताकि आप वो घटना एक घटना है लेकिन उसके आसपास एक यूनिवर्स है यू नो दैट पर्सन इज़ अ होल यूनिवर्स उसकी एक ज़िंदगी है उसके माँ बाप है उसकी जो उसकी पूरी ज़ाती ज़िंदगी है वो पूरी दुनिया जब आप कागज़ पे उतारते हैं तो आप उसको देख सकते हैं पर्सपेक्टिव में कि भाई ये आपको उसका पूरा 360 डिग्री पर्सपेक्टिव मिलेगा तो फॉर दैट यू हैव टू आस्क क्वेश्चन सो आई वॉज आस्किंग बट आई वॉज वेरी पोलाइट डेलिकेट एंड रिस्ट्रेंड इन आस्किंग इफ यू गिव टाइम इन द इंटरव्यू द पर्सन स्पीक्स And I would listen, and I would tape. I would not take notes because that makes people, you know, nervous.
Yeah.
And then with those tapes, I would return home. And when I would listen to them again, first thing I do is transcribe. I cannot. I'm very old-fashioned. Like I transcribe the whole thing, and then I will work on my story. So that was very, you know, horrible. It was devastating. So, and while listening to the tapes, I would look at the photographs on the laptop while transcribing so that I, you know, can go back into that. I also make small clips for my personal use, for my reference material for writing. So I would go back to that material. And if you're sitting alone in your small accommodation, like on fifth floor of some cheap Delhi suburb, some gaon, and it's June, you know, it's and you have a small cooler in your house which is running, तो उसकी घर घर की आवाज़ आती है कूलर की और आप सुनने की कोशिश कर रहे होते हो लगातार, तो वो बहुत तकलीफ दे होता है. पर मैंने उसको लिखा पूरा, बट मुझे लगता है वो, यू नो, आई वुड क्राई एंड आपका मन अजीब सा हो जाता है, आप बहुत बहुत ज़्यादा असहज हो जाता है. आई थिंक आई वॉज पीपल अराउंड मी, इट रियली इम्पैक्टेड माई रिलेशनशिप्स ऑल्सो. आई बिकेम काइंड ऑफ अ डार्क बॉल विच वॉज इन अ वेरी वियर्ड काइंड ऑफ, यू नो, लॉस्ट जोन, लॉस्ट माई ओन कोऑर्डिनेट्स. एंड so I was not the happy chilled out, you know, 28, 27, 6 year old like people are normally in that age. It was a ball of darkness for a long period of time.
And yet in this kind of reporting there are also these very deep connections that you make with people. There's also impact, you know? Some stories move forward because a reporter has come back maybe after 4, 5, or 6 years and is pushing to reveal the facts. And the family find a kind of succor, a kind of support in just the presence of the reporter. So there's also that, it's not an even balance, but often there is that also.
Yes, I think because reporters are not reaching, there's a lot of good journalism happening in India. But with that disclaimer, I would like to say that in my limited experience, in my limited humble experience, I went to places where I feel that media has not reached. Because when I would go and I would interview and I would come back, you know, walk out of the house, I would see mothers and father parents, you know, they would come out with folded hands. They had so much hope in, you know, from that report. People normally, a lot of people ask me something like, क्या आप उनको, मतलब क्या वो इस बात से इरिटेट नहीं होते सर्वाइवर्स या उनकी फैमिलीज की आप बार बार उनकी तकलीफ को वो कर रहे हैं या उकेर रहे हैं या उनसे परेशान कर रहे हैं. पर ये लोगों को मालूम ही नहीं है कि ये तो कुछ ही किस्सों के साथ होता है जो मीडिया में हाईलाइट हो जाते हैं. जो बहुत ज़्यादा ऐसी कैसे केसेस हैं उनको ज़रूरत, जिनको मीडिया अटेंशन की वाकई ज़रूरत है, जहाँ तक पहुँचता नहीं है, जहाँ तक हम आवाज़ नहीं पहुँचती, मीडिया पहुँचता नहीं है. तो अगर आप उन केसेस की बात लें तो लोग इतने ज़्यादा, उनको उम्मीद बन जाती है आपके आने से, वो बाहर तक आते हैं आपको छोड़ने.
कुछ लोगों के लिए सिर्फ ये बहुत है कि किसी ने आकर उनकी कहानी सुनी,
उससे उनको बहुत, नो, आई हैड सर्वाइवर्स हु स्पोक एंड दे spoke to me and then they would ask me for to stay back for dinner, lunch, and they would hug me and then, you know, they will cry, I will cry, and then you know the normalization, the way which they treated me as a human being and with so much affection and compassion, you know, that also teaches you a lot.
Yeah,
that you should also treat them as whole human beings and not melodramatize it as, you know, as a case or victim or survivor, but as a whole person who has her grace and dignity which should be kept intact in the story.
Yeah. So on that note, Priyanka, I'm going to read a very small passage from your book. This is from the chapter on the Bhagana gang rape case. Yeah. It's called The Anatomy of a Rape in Haryana. Yeah. And here's a passage. Ritika's younger sister, 13-year-old Janvi, is the youngest of all the 4 survivors in the Bhagana gang rape. She was kidnapped barely 500 meters away from her home, along with Sushma, 17, Leela, 17, and Meena, 18. Ritika points her finger towards the now deserted veranda and says, "We grew up here." Since she was the youngest child of the family, she was always a bit pampered, but never more than my brothers. We would play together here, talk, laugh, cook, and sometimes even fight. She had a few dolls, and sometimes we ran around playing juggo in this veranda. When we grew up, we would cook, talk, and occasionally watch TV serials together. Later, she says, "When I think about her now, all I feel is that she was too small, too fragile to go through such a brutal attack. My mother told me that she was in a bad condition when she returned home after that night. She was partially conscious, her body was still bleeding, and she was in severe pain. I know men routinely attack and abuse girls here, but still I feel she was too small to go through that. Her despair is so deep, writes Priyanka. It's as if Ritika doesn't believe that Janvi's fate was avoidable, only that she wishes it could be delayed till she was older. There are so many passages like this in the book. It's really hard to read the whole book in one go because the way in which you have brought these small moments alive for the reader, you can see two little girls playing together. You feel that you could be one of them. You remember your own childhood when you read about a child. And I can see that it's having that effect on you. What taught you? How did you teach yourself? What were the decisions you took when you decided that a book about violence is also going to be a book about deep empathy?
I was educated in journalism schools, but I think I'm. Everything I learned about journalism was outside those classrooms. There we learned how to make page and what is intro and all those jargons. But I think libraries. I grew up in Bhopal. It's a two-tier city. And there was a library there in that town. I think that library was a game changer for me. I think a lot of this has to do with intuition. It's natural and it cannot be injected. Because I remember one of my teachers once said that journalists cannot be, taught, and you cannot teach someone to make and convert the person into a journalist. There are no factories where journalists are made. We are, it's something, it's absolutely like love, ya to hota ya nahi hota. So ya to aapke andar wo hai ya nahi hai. So a lot of this was intuitive, and I think I am
natural. And yet our intuition also leads us in certain directions. Then we find our writing mentors. When we are reading others, there are some things that we connect to,
and
some others that we don't, and we go in that direction.
There was the British Library had a small branch in Bhopal. Later they transferred that branch to MP government, but the library thankfully retained. There was a small section on journalism in that library. All the books still have my pencil marks. I lived literally in that library during my university years, and I like chartered like all the books up. Maine padh liye ekdam. There was one book which was titled The Great Reporters by David Randall in that library. वो मेरी पहली खिड़की थी ना दुनिया में. हम बहुत छोटे थे, हमको पता नहीं था कि सेंट स्टीफन्स, जब मैंने 12th पास किया तो मुझे ये भी नहीं मालूम था कि सेंट स्टीफन्स किस चिड़िया का नाम है या दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी में कैसे दाखिला मिलता है. हम बहुत ही प्रोटेक्टेड एनवायरमेंट में बड़े हुए और बहुत ही ज़्यादा रिजर्वड और कॉन्जर्वेटिव एनवायरमेंट था. उसमें वो पहली किताब थी जिससे मुझे लगा कि मैं कुछ ऐसा करना चाह रही रिजेंबल. उसमें तीन औरतों की कहानियाँ भी थी, 10 लोग थे उसमें. 10 ग्रेट रिपोर्टर्स वर क्रॉनिकल्ड. आई रियली रिकमेंड दैट बुक टू ऑल पीपल हु वांट टू बी जर्नलिस्ट और हु वांट टू डू जर्नलिज्म, द ग्रेट रिपोर्टर्स बाय डेविड रैंडाल. सो उसमें तीन औरतों की कहानी, उसमें आई थिंक नली ब्लाय थी एक और एक एडना बुचनान, द ग्रेट मियामी क्राइम रिपोर्टर. आई वॉज और तीसरी का नाम मुझको याद नहीं आ रहा, बट और भी बहुत सारे मैंने आई रेड ऑल द 10 स्टोरीज. पहला वॉर कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंट जिसके आँख में ऐसे स्कार लग गया था, और इतनी अमेजिंग स्टोरीज थी वो. मैं झील के किनारे बैठ के पाँव लटका के उनको पढ़ती थी, और पैरापेटिक होता था वहाँ पे, और आई वॉज फिल्ड विथ एनर्जी एंड विजन. मेरे पास, क्योंकि हमारे पास कोई ऐसे ट्यूटर्स थे नहीं, मतलब हम कहीं हार्वर्ड या ऐसी बड़ी जगहों पे पढ़े नहीं, हमको कभी किसी ने बताया नहीं कि ऐसा बनना है, तो हमें खुद ही रास्ते ढूंढने पड़े. और हमको जैसे ही वो एक धागा मिला ना, मतलब तो मैंने उसको पकड़ लिया. मेरी पूरी जो एजुकेशन रही बहुत द्रोणाचार्य फॉर्म में रही है. मतलब एक दो एडिटर्स थे जो, एक बैंगलोर में निशा सुजैन रहती थी, वो तहलका में, शी वॉज माई कलीग, शी वॉज फीचर्स एडिटर इन तहलका. 2014 में व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड फ्रीलांसिंग, आई रोड अ लॉट फॉर याहू ओरिजिनल्स. शी वॉज द एडिटर देयर इन याहू. सो वो एडिट करके बैक एंड फोर्थ करती थी मेरे साथ बहुत जब हम लिखते थे. तो तीन चार ड्राफ्ट्स होते थे. अंग्रेजी में रियाज आपका बहुत अच्छा होता है जब आप अंग्रेजी में लिखते हैं. उनकी जो ड्राफ्टिंग प्रोसेस है दैट दैट रियली इवॉल्व्स यू. तो मैंने उनको एक दिन लिखा जब कहानी फाइनली आई कि ये कहानी उन्होंने एडिट भी करी थी कि यू नो यू आर माई द्रोणाचार्य. आई फील लाइक एक लव यू. क्योंकि हमें ऐसे क्लासरूम्स अभी मिले नहीं, ऐसे कोई टीचर्स थे नहीं, हमको मालूम नहीं था कि कैसे करना है. तो हमने चीज़ें पकड़ी फिर. और मेरे को इतना इंटरेस्ट था रिपोर्टिंग में. मुझे लगता था कि इसको और अच्छे से, मतलब कि पांच लड़कियां अगर या एक फैमिली जंतर मंतर पे इतने दिन से प्रोटेस्ट कर रही है और ये कह रही है कि उनके साथ ऐसा हुआ है, तो हाउ टू मेक द वर्ल्ड केयर अबाउट इट, यू नो, व्हिच इज़ पासिंग बाय रोड्स. तो उनको कैसे पकड़ के हम उनका उनकी कॉलर कैसे हिलाएं हमको कि वो ये पढ़ें और उनको उस चीज़ को महसूस करें जिस सिंपैथी से हम उसको फील करते हैं. तो मुझे लगा कि इसके लिए ना डिटेल्स बहुत ज़रूरी हैं. आप उनको सिर्फ अगर 200 वर्ड में दिखाएंगे कैसे तो वो शायद मूव ना हो, पर आप उनको पूरी दुनिया में ले जाइए, उसकी दुनिया में दाखिल कराइए और बताइए कि ये खाता भी ऐसे, सोता ऐसे, रहता जीता ऐसे, इसके सपने ये हैं, ये बनना चाहता था, ये इसकी माँ है, इसने इतना प्यार करता है, ये इसकी ज़िंदगी. उसको एक इंसान के तौर पर जब आप ज़िंदा करेंगे कागज़ पर तो लोग रिलेट करेंगे, क्योंकि हम सब इंसान हैं और ये पूरी एक ह्यूमन कनेक्ट का पूरा साइकिल है. मतलब इट्स ऑल अबाउट कनेक्टिंग ह्यूमन बींग्स विद ह्यूमन बींग्स. उसके लिए आपको वर्ड्स की ज़रूरत है. तो ये मुझे बहुत लगता है कि सब एडिटर्स को समझना चाहिए और रिपोर्टर्स को, और इसको इनकरेज करना चाहिए. इससे चिढ़ना नहीं चाहिए कि गलत शब्द में आप बकवास रैंडमली, ना, देर इज ऑलरेडी अलॉट ऑफ हंड्रेड गार्बेज इन द वर्ल्ड, एक बार किसी राइटर ने कहा था, डोंट ऐड टू इट. मगर आप अगर अच्छे से लिखेंगे तो लोग कनेक्ट करते हैं. मतलब एडिटर्स किस लिए, हम किस लिए, और हम लोग बिल्कुल तैयार रहते हैं. आप हमसे 5 ड्राफ्ट करा लीजिए, 6 ड्राफ्ट करा लीजिए, मेहनत करने में बिल्कुल पीछे नहीं है. आप बोलिए कि तुमने कूड़ा लिखा है, मैं उसको 10 बार लिख के दूंगी. आई एम रेडी टू वर्क हार्ड, यू नो, बट बिलीव इन अ लॉन्ग स्टोरी, यू नो, गिव मी द स्पेस टू टेल द स्टोरी. आई नीड स्पेस.
आई थिंक इट रियली इज अ ग्रेट फैलेसी ऑफ आवर टाइम्स दैट पीपल डोंट हैव अटेंशन स्पैन्स. पीपल are constantly consuming the media, so clearly they are spending enough time trying to find things that they connect with.
And they
accept long form in video, in film, as well as in the form of books and longer written pieces.
I think we have competition now from Netflix and all these new formats as well. You know, there are so many avenues and the attention span is so little, time is little. So how to engage the reader is the question. I think as humans also people should, मतलब अगर आप इतनी दारुण कथाओं पे, इतनी मुश्किल या जो इतनी हार्ट रेंडिंग स्टोरीज हैं उन पे अगर आपका ध्यान नहीं जा रहा तो क्या किया जा सकता है इसके बारे में फिर. मतलब वो भी वही बात है कि या तो होता है या तो नहीं होता है, तो फिर
नो, समवेयर यू जस्ट carry on. I mean, somewhere you have to take a decision and say, I believe the story needs to be told.
I believe, yes.
And that's unshakable.
And I think first time maybe you are not able to convert a person into your reader, but if you keep doing this kind of work, someday with every story your readers grow, you know.
That's absolutely true.
Yeah,
that,
if you believe
that you have
in
to
story,
invest in the body of work also of work as also. A writer.
Yes, yes.
I want to ask you another question. So we associate the telling of stories about women with women writers. But in your actual lived experience, how hard or easy was it for you to write this book? Because it took you into places where you were yourself vulnerable as a woman.
Yeah.
It took you into police stations that were hostile. It made you travel on trains and buses and stay alone in places or have to rely on stringers or strangers who you did not know. What was that experience like? How would you kind of look back at it now?
I think it was very difficult. It was challenging. Two things I always keep in mind is that the driver I'm picking up should come through a trusted channel. That has to be there. You know, we just cannot. You are yourself a journalist, and you know that. You know, we just cannot go to a city and pick up any random driver and call a travel agency and say ki hame jana hai. So the driver has to come through either the stringer or somebody you trust in that area. So and you have to develop. I had developed a network of people, stringers. I don't like to use that word. People who are local reporters, I think, is a more respectable word.
Yeah, much more dignified word.
Dignified word. So I developed a network of local reporters who you know who develop a rapport when you work with them, when they see that what your work ethics are. I felt in my career, in my short span of career, that you get respect and a lot of cooperation if the person on ground feels that she's really, you know, she really wants to do
the
story.
Invested in the work. She
has a mind at the right place, so you get support. So I've also traveled on bikes of local reporters, you know, riding pillion for like 60, 70 kilometers, and they have gone to great lengths to support me, and most of them were males, like 90-100% were males. I don't remember working with a female local reporter ever. That is one stark difference, you know. It just,
yeah,
it just made me think.
And yet, you know, the stereotype is that there are these disadvantages. So when editors are thinking, when newsrooms are deciding who do I send to Purulia,
yeah,
they will think of the young men,
yeah,
or they will think of the experienced men. You know, that you're a woman, you have grown up in a city, that you are young, all of these are seen as disadvantages.
Disadvantages.
And I'm really keen to hear your experience, because my own experience as a camera person in my 20s, reporting for NDTV, is that all of these were actually literally my advantages.
Yes, yes.
You know, the world kind of responds to you, steps forward to protect you and get your work done. When they see the single-mindedness with which you want to do your own work.
I absolutely agree with you, Natasha, here. I feel that I got a lot of support from people on ground. Obviously, police stations are hostile, but you are working to the station with someone, you know, who is a local reporter. You're going to places with someone who is... So people, you have to face, obviously, when I'm entering a police station, say in Latehar or in Bandaria, which is a naxal infested area, I'm talking to the person on my own. But those places are hostile, but you still develop a kind of ecosystem which supports you. And I think as a reporter, it doesn't matter, you know, which organization you're working in. You're working for Washington Post, BBC or Caravan or any other organization, Tehelka. Your true strength lies in the network of these people. That is what you earn. You don't earn money. You have to earn people. You know, that and that is a long route, a long form. That is a time-taking process. But I have invested all my life in developing limited but warm friendships with people I work with on ground. You know, I know their families, I know the name of their children, I often go to their homes, I treat them as human beings, as my as colleagues, as people who are working with me, and that really helps. You know, I think we need to give that respect to people we work with, and we should,
as well as gratitude.
Obviously, gratitude is most important, and we as reporters should not think that we are working in, you know, very high fi. Ek reporter ki jo haisiyat ya jo uski strength hai na, wo pura uska system, uska network, uske jo log hain, ekdam ye ek yahan pe ye kuch politician jaisa ye kaam pesha ho jata hai.
Aapki log hi become the face, but it's actually your team.
Log hi aapki taakat hai. Matlab agar ya fir koi bhi aur politician shayad ek appropriate, mujhe nahi pata kitna. I think you're getting what I want to say from that analogy. What I want to say is कि लोग आपकी ताकत हैं जिनके साथ आप काम करते हैं, जो आपके रिपोर्टर्स हैं. जैसे मैंने एक I did a cover story on dacoits in Chambal. So I was alone with my driver. So that driver came through a channel. He was told ki ye ghar ki ladki hai, to aap usko le. Hum pure Bhind, Morena, Gwalior, matlab 10 din tak hum ghoom rahe hain. We are meeting former dacoits, surrender dacoits. We are going to godforsaken places, right? And network hi nahi hai, dono phones mein network nahi hai. But कोई भी पेट्रोल पंप आता था वो पहले ही रोक देते थे. His name was मोहिनी भैया कि मैडम आपको वॉशरूम तो नहीं जाना. So no, that is the kind of rapport you develop with people. Mm-hmm. So वो मुझे लगता है सबसे prized है जिसको लोग neglect करते हैं.
There's another roadblock that I feel the traditional idea of journalism constantly places in our paths, which is that if a story has been done once, or if a story has become old, then it is no longer relevant for a reporter to do again. So you're told, is there a development? Is there a breaking news? Is there an anniversary? what are you adding to this? This has already been done, even though the story is actually continues to be alive. It's not been resolved. people are living the injustice that you want to talk about. But it's been carried once by some, you know, broadcaster or newspaper, and then you are inhibited from, you are told that it is not worth doing the story again. But you've crossed that barrier again and again. What is it that you tell yourself, and what is it that you want to tell other journalists?
So, I think first of all, I really try and very, I do not agree with this thing, this idea that the story is old now, what is new in it. It's a very, you know, it's a question that we face every day, of course, in our newsrooms and with our editors.
Yeah, but I think it's also a very outdated concept. It belongs to the time when there was only one channel of news.
I think that, I feel as a reporter that this question is ridiculous, of course, but we have to face it.
But it's a question that you have to answer constantly.
Constantly.
Yeah, in the newsroom.
Constantly. So, one is that I try very hard to bring something, to find an angle, or to look at the story from a certain prism, or to look for legal documents, or to make it in-depth. If when you go in-depth, you are bound to come up with things that have not been
reported.
So yeah, that is one way of dealing it. But you know, that of course that is what we do. As a reporter, we are not fools ki hum wahi cheez likhenge jo kal chapi parso chapi. But we do that much. But on principle, I think that till date, we keep seeing children, asking us for money, 1 rupees, 2 rupees on traffic lights. The problem of street children is not going anywhere. We need stories. Till date, rapes keep happening. Till date, gender crimes keep happening. We need to do stories. Till the date, trafficking keeps happening. We need to do stories. जब हम इतनी सारी चीज़ें कर सकते हैं, when we can spend so many pages on celebrity and on all these kind of stories, then real issues should be reported. If people are dying of malnutrition, then they are dying of malnutrition. Yeah. They were dying in 2005, they were dying in 2007, they were dying in 2015, and they are still dying. So we still need to do the story. So this is one thing that I tell editors also, tell people, tell myself also, that because people are still dying of malnutrition, we still need to do these stories. Because women are still dying while giving birth, we still need to do the story. That because women are still being raped, so we need to do these stories. Hum tabhi rukenge jab ye cheeze ruk jaye. So obviously, as reporters, we will work on the form, we'll work on getting good photographs, we'll take a DSLR with us, we'll work on clips, audio, video, aur wo sare hum sajavat kar sakte hain, but story ki atma to wahi rahegi na. We have to do the story because it's still happening. That's the only reason. Mm-hmm. I think that drives any reporter.
To come back to No Nation for Women, yeah, how did this book deal happen? Hard was it to get this book deal?
No, it came my way. I did a series on police women, which was published by Yahoo Originals. And then Dharini, she was my acquisitions editor, and I know that
Dharini
she,
Bhaskar.
Yeah, Dharini, yeah. Bhaskar, she was yours also. She was the editor. She wrote to me. She said that would I like to do a book around this. She was very impressed by those three articles, and I was already thinking about doing something, but the thoughts were very, very raw. They were not shaped, and they were only in my head. So when Dharini's email came, her email came in 2014, June 2014. And I think after 2 or 3 months, I was initially very intimidated by the whole process of by the publishing contract and everything. But I asked her, very honest. So I asked people that, listen, I'm intimidated. Can you please explain this to me? So she was very kind and she explained. And I signed the contract, and then Dharini changed organization. And so the book came to
a new organization.
It was finally published by Simon & Schuster. And my editor here was Dharini, left the organization also in between. It took me so long. And I got married, she had a baby, and then I got a...
and then Himanjali Sarkar finished
then
it with
Himanjali
you.
Sarkar, she really worked very hard with me on this book. And she was very supportive in Satyan, and the whole team at Simon & Schuster, they were very supportive. But I, thankfully, I had to do nothing to get this book deal. They...
It came to me. So there is power in one's words.
There power is one's words.
My final question, there's the high that the book is ready, the book launch has happened. And then there are the little lows when you're wondering where the book has reached or how to make it reach the places that you want it to go to. Because you think that the ultimate milestone is getting it published, but then you realize the ultimate milestone is now standing next to it and
push it out. Either
it travels on its own or you make an effort to take it places. How has that been for you?
I think I was very exhausted after working on this book. When it got published, while writing it, I imagined every day. I imagined myself, in the launch wearing a sari. And I imagined myself. Whenever I would get nervous, I would feel that I can't do it anymore. I would imagine that I have to ensure that the book comes out. I will be happy that day, when the book comes out. I always imagined that I will be happy when the book
comes
out.
And you were. You had a great launch.
Launch. But I was actually... When the first public announcement of the book was made, I was very exhausted, I think, at that time. I was not that much happy, I'd imagined that I will be. I was okay. There was a lot of gravity which I felt in myself for the first time.
That's imaginable because it's also a story a book that has the stories of so many other people. These are not fictional characters. Not fictional. They are real people.
So I was that's there. I was exhausted, and the launch happened, and after that I felt more exhausted. But I had to continue. Like there were a couple of requests for book signing or things like that, and small things, interviews or something. So I was doing them. But I was talking to a friend of mine yesterday, and we were talking about the same thing that you were talking, that you, the question that you asked me, and we realized, we both feel that that the book is like a river. Once you finish it, you leave it. It will find its journey on its own. It will reach people who are thirsty. So that is one way of putting it. If it has power, it will reach those who are thirsty for it. And I, as a reader, also feel that, I'm reading books of writers who have died like 50 years ago, 100 years ago, 200 years ago. So book is something jiska asar bahut saalon baad dikhai deta hai. At least, we should be. In this age, it's very difficult. Patience is the most difficult thing to have in this age. But I think that we will see the impacts of our books in a couple of years from now.
You're absolutely right about that. This book is certainly like a river. No Nation for Women. I highly recommend it. Don't be intimidated by the book. As much as it has stories of trauma, it also has stories of the resilience of the human spirit. And you will certainly, certainly enjoy the writing of Priyanka Dubey. Thank you, Priyanka.
Thank you, Natasha. Thank you very much for this lovely conversation.